is, as you know, our last hour, our ethics professionalism hour. To my right is Jeff Milsteen of the State Law Department. To his left, Jerry Weber of the Southern Center for Human Rights and in private practice. And I'll let them do their presentations, and then again, we'll have everyone stick around for more questions afterwards.
The new Open Records Act really in particular encourages the government and the requester to interact and cooperate as to formats, timing, payment. And the goals of that are really twofold. One is to lead to greater clarity for the government agency as to exactly what the citizen wants, and to streamline and hopefully lessen the cost for the requester. So I'm really going to speak to that interaction between the requester or the attorney for the requester and the government agency, and how to facilitate that process and what changes in the open records law in particular help facilitate that process. And the reality is that when either a citizen or a lawyer uses the Open Records Act, they're rarely familiar with the precise documents they seek. They have questions, and through records, they're seeking answers to those questions. They're usually not aware of what databases it's in, what format it's in, and often the requester doesn't really care about the particular identifiers of individuals. They really want to know answers to their questions. And these black box sort of aspects to the citizen not knowing exactly how the government records are kept often leads to citizens making initial pretty broad requests for documents. I mean, consider like this as an example. Let's suppose you're a parent or a lawyer representing a parent whose child was disciplined by a bus driver on a school bus. And you want to know, did the bus driver have the power to do that? Was the bus driver ever trained? And maybe whether the bus driver ever had any problems with disciplining students before. So the citizen or the lawyer, when they request documents, they don't know whether these are going to be in some manual or in some standard operating procedures. They don't know what format the training records are going to take. And they probably don't care about whether other bus drivers were trained. They want to know whether the bus driver of their kid's school bus was trained. And so that black box aspect leads to oftentimes a pretty broad request. And in response, there's often shock, because the governmental entity will have usually, or oftentimes, a large price tag for retrieving those records because the request was really broad. I've had a request that I've made where the government agency comes back and wants $500,000 or $750,000 for the records. And sometimes that request is a jacked up figure to deter access. I had one case where I requested the internal affairs file on a particular police officer. The agency came back and said, this is going to cost thousands of dollars. We filed a lawsuit, and it turned out that in order to access that record, one had to open up a file cabinet, pull out the file with the guy's name on it, and do a few redactions. Only took a few minutes. Oftentimes, though, the request is simply too broad. I had a request one time where my response from the government agency was, this will be about $700,000. As I talked to, and I do mean that, talked to the lawyer for the government agency, learned about how the records were kept, how they were organized, I was able to reduce that request from that huge figure down to under $20,000, which was still pretty pricey, but there were a lot of records requested. So this interaction can lead to a significant reduction of the costs and a lot of clarity for both sides. And that discussion needs to occur, and the new Open Records Act really encourages that, because the other option to not talking is to either file a lawsuit or to talk to the Attorney General's office and see if they can mediate the problem, and they have very few resources for this issue, which is expanding, and probably expanding more with the revisions to the Act. So, first thing I want to speak to is the issue of cost, and some of these issues will echo what Tom discussed, but I want to put them in particular categories. When one makes a request for records, depending upon the valuation of the search and retrieval, there's going to be one of three responses. If the request is for records that ultimately cost less than $25, then the government agency has to produce them. There's no more back and forth. They produce those records. This is under OCGA 50.17.71D. If the records cost between $25 and $500, then there is a separate process. And the government agency can respond and say, it's going to cost $125. They can produce the records, or they can make that written response, get a buy-in from the requester to, in fact, pay those costs for the records. So if you're in the $25 to $500 range, the government agency may not give you the records. They can, but they may instead say, it's going to cost this much, will you fork up the dough? The third category is if the records will cost, according to the government agency, more than $500. And in that case, the government agency can require, is not required to require, but can require payment upfront. Now, also, if the requester has previously made a request sometime in the past and not actually paid for the records that they requested, that rule also applies. So even if it's a smaller amount in terms of dollars for response to the records, if the requester has previously requested records, didn't pay for them, then the government agency can require payment up front for those records. So there's those three levels, essentially, where there's a fee associated with the records. Now, you get over that hurdle, and the requester believes that the response is kind of too expensive for them, basically. Now, there's three primary tools at that stage for this back and forth with the government agency's lawyers in order to reduce the amount or the cost of the request. The most obvious is to actually narrow the request. And there's one change in particular, 50.17.71G, dealing with emails and text messages. One of the particularly difficult aspects of this black box of a government agency in requesting records is sometimes you don't know whose emails you really want. And you don't know the subject matter of those emails. You don't know the search terms. Well, if it is possible to identify particular persons, if it is possible to identify particular search terms for those emails, you're obligated now under 50.17.71G to do that. So you can't just toss out a broad request for all emails about a particular subject. Actually, you can, but your response may be from the government agency, you got to fork up several thousands of dollars. And this is a way that the revisions to the act require the requester, if they can, if possible, to narrow the request both as to subject matter, search terms, and email addresses. The second aspect in terms of reducing cost is that the Open Records Act allows for three options in terms of how you get the records. One is you can ask for copies, and now the cost for those copies is reduced to 10 cents a page from 25 cents a page. The second that is now provided for in the Act is that you can self-scan. You can go there with a portable scanner and scan the documents, save your 10 cents a page, which if it's a voluminous request and you've got somebody who can spend the time making those scans, you can reduce the cost. The third option, which I think is underutilized a lot of times, especially with extensive requests, is that the citizen or the citizen's lawyer has a right to inspect the records instead of requesting copies. And oftentimes, especially in a voluminous request, the requester really wants to get a general sense of what the records look like. Is there a problem? Are there lots of school bus drivers who've had lots of complaints about their discipline? So it may be that the citizen can work with the government agency and inspect those records. Now, there is the problem of redaction. And that problem is one that can be pierced. Now, each of the exemptions under the Open Records Act are not mandatory. The government agency need not wholeheartedly, completely comply with those exemptions. They're to be construed narrowly. Sometimes a failure to comply with those exemptions may lead to liability, and then there is a separate legal obligation. For example, we talked about FERPA records, and there is an implication for a school system if they produce educational records, individual educational records that are protected by FERPA. But some of the exemptions do not have a counterpart where there would be an implication for the government agency to allow somebody to look through the records. In those cases, there can be a right to inspect without redaction. I've even consented to a situation where I would agree to inspect, but to not take any notes, because I just want a general sense of what these records look like. Is there a problem here? And so if the government agency works with the citizen, that can be done for certain categories of exemptions. And in that way, the cost is reduced, and the parties, you know, can avoid sometimes litigation about the issue. Now, those times often require a level of trust between the lawyer, the requester, and the government agency. And, you know, like an agreement not to take notes, for example. And if that level of trust can be created and can be worked with, then oftentimes, also for the decision of inspection versus copying, a government agency can agree to allow the citizen or the requester to inspect the records without having to pay somebody to sit there watching them inspect the records. And that demands a level of trust that the citizen's not going to take the records and stick them in their pocket or rip them up or whatever. But that level of cooperation can and has been reached a lot of times where there are especially voluminous open records requests. And a lot of what I'm speaking to is those kinds of situations, because if it's a small request, copying costs isn't going to be a big deal, and it's not going to affect the ultimate charge for the records. A more significant change in the law is the formats in which the records may be produced or must be produced. And under 501771F, the changes require or create a lot more flexibility in how the records can or must be produced, and those changes allow for the government agency sometimes to produce the records in an easier way and allow for the citizen to pay a lot less for the records. Now, under 501771F, the beginning of the section says, as provided in this subsection, the agency's use of electronic record-keeping systems must not erode the public's right of access to records under this article. So the fact that there is some sort of computer maintenance of records as opposed to paper maintenance of records cannot be used as a tool to reduce access to records. Under that section, there's many options for the citizen. The citizen can request electronic copies. They can request printouts, or they can request data or data fields. So they can request any one of those three formats. Now, as to data fields, now the law is clarified. If a citizen wants certain data fields in a database, they can request that the government agency provide those data fields and not the others. And the government agency cannot reject the request or refuse to comply with the request because they have to do search for particular parameters, particular search terms. They have to execute the commands that are available under their existing computer software. A government agency is not required to develop a new piece of software because a citizen has requested a certain types of documents. But if the existing software allows for searches of in use of particular commands, the government agency has to do that and provide the records that are ultimately produced in one of those three formats: printouts, electronic copies, or data fields. And whatever the citizen wants, the citizen gets along those lines. As to the formats, there are two possibilities under 501771 for electronic records. One is that the government agency can produce the records in the standard export format that they have. The second option is that they can provide ASCII files. So those are the two formats that are provided. And the citizen can come in with a thumb drive, they can download it onto the thumb drive, or the government agency can provide a thumb drive and make them pay for the thumb drive. And again, that's the citizen's choice because under the overarching fee provisions, the most economical means always have to be employed by the government agency. So if a citizen can talk to the government lawyer and say, hey, I can do this cheaper myself by bringing in my own thumb drive, that has to be allowed. The next provision, sort of on this data field subject, is websites. Under 501771H, if the information is available that the citizen has requested on a website, the government agency can direct the citizen to where that information is available on the website. And the citizen may, but is not required to, access the information in that way. They can still request the printout, and maybe some citizens who don't have computer capability would make that request. And they'd have to pay the copying charges for that. But now, specifically in the law, the government agency can come back and say, hey, we put that information up on the website. As Tom mentioned, especially if there are frequently requested items, they oftentimes will be targeted to a website. You know, government agency will put it up there just for ease of access for citizens and to reduce kind of their headache of lots of requests. The last issue, or second to last issue really, is the question of timing. Now, the Open Records Act has always had this provision about 3 business days for response. But now under 501771B1A, there's now 3 tiers again. First, if the records are available in 3 business days, they are accessible by the government agency, they have to produce them. End of story. If some but not all of the records are available within 3 business days, because let's say there, some of the records are off-site, those records that are available within the 3 business day time still have to be produced, no questions asked. But those records that are off-site, there's a different rule. The government agency still has to respond within 3 business days as to those records, still has to provide a written response. And in that response, where the records are off-site or otherwise unavailable within 3 business days, the government agency has to say what records are available, will be available at a later point, and a specific timeline as to when those records will be available. Now, there may be some litigation down the line as to how quick that response has to be, and it's going to really depend upon the nature of the difficulty in terms of accessing those records. And there was a question in Tom's session about, well, what are the remedies if the government agency just doesn't respond? You make a request, 3 business days pass, no response at all. In addition to communicating with the Attorney General's office about the issue, in addition to talking to the object of the request, the custodian of the records or the custodian's attorney, the filing of a lawsuit is available, and now there are 2 Georgia appellate decisions, and I should have brought the cites to them, that hold that a complete failure to respond within 3 business days is an automatic, essentially, liability for attorney's fees. That a complete failure to respond lacks substantial justification, which is the key terms for an obligation to pay attorney's fees for a lawsuit under the Open Records or Open Meetings Act. So if you make a request, 3 business days pass, and usually, you know, most lawyers will say 3 really means 5 unless they really need the records fast, you know, or even 7. But if there's a substantial period of time after the 3 business days where there is no response to your request, you can prove in fact that it's been received, whether you use certified mail or if it's email, there's a mechanism for doing that. Then a lawsuit will obligate the government agency to pay attorney's fees. That's for a complete failure to respond. So for those government lawyers out there, making sure that your clients know that they have to send in a letter if they can't get the records within 3 business days. If they have the records, they have to produce them within 3 business days. That will ensure that nobody runs off and files a lawsuit, and then you're hit with attorney's fees for failure to respond, complete failure to respond to a request. Related to that, there's another change that impacts the oral written email request question. And that's 50-17-71-B3. Now, there have been bills in the General Assembly every year for the last several years that would seek to prohibit citizens from making oral requests for records. That was also an issue before the General Assembly in this last session. The General Assembly, I think, wisely preserved the ability of citizens to make oral requests for records. But as a compromise, if a citizen makes an oral request for records, they can't go to court and enforce that failure to respond through a lawsuit. The only way they can do that under 50-17-71-B3 is to make a written request. So unless one makes a written request or a written request by email, they cannot use the enforcement provisions and seek injunctive relief and ultimately possibly attorney's fees for a failure to respond to that request. And that ensures that, in fact, there's no confusion about whether the government agency received the request. If it's an oral request, sometimes legitimately government agencies were concerned that, well, how do we prove that we never received the request? Well, now it's clear that if you're going to go to court and enforce a request, it has to be written or in email form. So, the net effect of these changes are that the game of hide the ball on both ends is largely eliminated. Both the requester and the government agency have to be as clear as they can about both what records are requested, what formats are desired, and the government agency has to be very clear about what records they have, what records they need to go and get, and more clear about the cost of those records, and encouraging, really, I think, in this process, an interaction where there's no longer just a letter that's sent out and a letter from the other from the government agency on the other side that says that'll be $12,000. That's only the beginning of the process now. Now, under the open records law, that leads to a discussion between the requester and the government agency about, well, what do you really want? Here's the formats in which we have it, and that interaction can lead to a significant reduction in the cost. And ultimately ensure that citizens have greater public access to these documents. Thanks.
Thanks, Jerry. I can't stress enough how important that last bit of advice is. It really is important, I think, in all of these cases to open up a dialogue. And frankly, the way that this bill, which I will say when the Attorney General first proposed it, had probably zero chance of passing because there were so many disparate interests involved and people didn't want to mess with the open records law, or the interests were so competing that no one thought a compromise could be reached. The fact is that it passed because all the stakeholders in the process actively participated. And certainly folks like Tom and Sean and Hollie were very involved in this process from the beginning, where it would have been easy for them to sit back and maybe just take shots at it, but instead they kind of stepped up to the table and sought to improve the bill. And I think that level of professionalism that occurred in the birthing of this bill, if you will, should be followed in attempts to comply with this bill. The truth is, I think, that a lot of agencies out there do want to fulfill their obligation under the law, despite what the notable exceptions suggest otherwise. But the truth is also that it is sometimes difficult to comply with the law, and as some of your questions to Tom earlier demonstrated, the law is still not crystal clear in all areas. It still requires a little massaging. And to the extent that you get a request that is not clear, if you're a public attorney, or if you're a requester, to the extent you make a request that's not clear, you're muddying the waters even further. And I think the goal in all of this, in making these requests and responding to these requests, should be to try to come to the common ground as quickly as possible to fulfill the obligation of the law to produce the records or to ensure that meetings are open, and not get into this game of playing gotcha. And, you know, I've been doing this in my current capacity as Chief Deputy Attorney General since 1997. And before that, I was the head of the local government, open government division in our office. So I've had about 20 years in dealing with these, and every time I think I've seen every possible situation that can come up, you know, three more will walk in the door the next day. But while we take our role very seriously in the enforcement side of this, we also have a role to play in providing our clients with advice on how to respond. So before I decide how many of you are going to be mad at me before this is all over, how many of you are actually public attorneys? Can you just raise your hands? Ah, good. Lots of you. That means you'll really be mad at me when this is over. How many of you are private attorneys representing public entities? Okay. How many of you just need an hour of ethics, Greg? The truth is, what I want to do is I want to go through briefly just sort of our office's role in the open government process, and then I want to talk to you about what, to my knowledge, is the only bar rule that deals specifically with public agencies, and that bar rule arose out of an open government dispute. And I think that's something that a lot of people aren't even aware of. And that gets into the issue of what public attorneys' responsibilities are with respect to assuring that the law is enforced. And I think that's very important. You know, private lawyers operate in a world where they give their client advice, and if the client says thank you very much and then ignores the advice, there's not much you do about that. I mean, you've given them the benefit of your advice. Public lawyers, I believe, have a higher responsibility to make sure the public interest is followed and that you have more obligations than private lawyers do. But we'll get into that in a minute. Our role in open government issues, first and foremost, we represent our clients. We represent every state agency, obviously, that exists. We are called on an almost daily basis to answer questions regarding meetings and records. We do our best to keep our clients informed on changes to the law. One thing you may not know, that in this whole discussion of attorney-client privilege and how that applies in responding to open records requests, in Georgia, the Attorney General is the only official authorized to represent, provide legal representations to state agencies. If you submit an open records request to a state agency and an attorney-client privilege is asserted with respect to communications with an in-house lawyer, not the Attorney General's office, that does not come under the attorney-client privilege. I don't think a lot of people are aware of that. Since 1995, this office has said consistently that only the Attorney General's office has an attorney-client privilege relationship with the state agencies, because we are the only ones by law authorized to represent them. So the truth is there are more lawyers in state agencies days than there are in the Attorney General's office, but they do not enjoy an attorney-client privilege relationship. And they know that, and we have been very explicit about that, and the official opinion, as I said, goes back to 1995. So, while the attorney-client privilege exception was expanded somewhat, I think in the changes to the law in certain areas, it still has some rather significant limitations out there, because most of the folks that requesters dealing with in agencies are probably that's number one. The other thing is, though, in addition to our representation of state agencies, we also represent the public. And we take that dual representation very seriously. It's something that many of you may not have to deal with, but it's something that is important to us. The open records law and the open meetings law, when it was updated, finally included within it a very strong statement of public interest and public intent. The law itself says explicitly that there is a strong public policy in favor of open government, that open government is essential to a free, open, and democratic society, and that public access to public records should be encouraged to foster confidence in government so that the public can evaluate the expenditure of public funds and the efficient and proper functioning of its institutions. Because of that strong policy interest, the General Assembly has specifically said, quote, there is a strong presumption that public records should be made available for public inspection without delay, that the law should be broadly construed in favor of openness, and that exceptions should be interpreted narrowly. In my view, all government attorneys, public or private, should keep this public interest in mind when working with clients on open government requests or disputes. And I'll get into that more a little bit later. The third thing we do is we have run for some years now a local government mediation program. We encourage requestors who are having difficulty getting information or getting access to meetings in the local government context to come to us to file a complaint and to allow us to try and mediate it. I will tell you that our goal in those mediations is compliance with the law, not sanctions. It's not to say we won't pursue sanctions. In an appropriate case, we will. But in probably 9 times out of 10, when we get these complaints that involve local governments, either there may be no basis to the complaint, or it may have been a simple misunderstanding. And again, I think those misunderstandings arise because folks don't follow Jerry's admonition to pick up the phone and call somebody, and it makes it very difficult. So we are not trying to be the enemy of local government in the mediation program. We don't always take the side of the requester. We are just trying to make sure that the law is complied with. The mediation program does not apply to state agencies. We only do it with local governments because we have separate enforcement authority with regard to compliance and those local governments, and we are trying to resolve disputes without having to go through the formal legal process. If, though, you have a problem with a state agency as a requester, and or if you're representing a local government and you have a question or you're concerned that a complaint is about to get made against you, or you just want to know what our view of the law is, we encourage you to call our office and talk through it. We don't have huge resources to deal with this issue. We've got a lawyer and a half, a lawyer two, maybe three at any given time that can be that have many, many other responsibilities and things to do that are also working on these issues. But we realize that it is much easier to resolve a problem informally on the front end than to have to deal with litigation on the back end. And so we really do encourage people to work with us in trying to resolve disputes before they get out of hand. And in that regard, if we get a complaint from a requester, an attorney, a citizen, a media outlet, or whatever, the first thing we do, obviously, is forward that complaint to the local government in question and ask them to respond. And then we'll go through a process to try and resolve it. We get requests ourselves in the office that are so incredibly broad that we try to be proactive about dealing with them. And I think that's something that a lot of public attorneys ought to do. If we get a request and we think we know what they're really asking for, despite the request itself being massively broad, just pick up the phone and call them and say, is this what you're looking for? Because we can get you this like in about 10 minutes. Rather than going off and trying to put together some response that you know is way beyond what they want, that's going to spend a lot of your time putting it together, and it's going to cost a lot of money. And I urge you as attorneys in this situation to be proactive about that. Don't just sit back and, again, I just see a lot of people that are playing gotcha with these requests. And it's just far easier to pick up the phone and say, did you want this memo? Is that what you're really looking for? Because you know, they don't know the words to use a lot of times to sort of penetrate the bureaucracy. And so I think it's better to just try to work with them. You know, a lot of government agencies, not as many as should have, but some have a culture of openness. Others see it, respond to these requests as more of a nuisance, but to the extent you can make it easier for them to respond, you know, you just make it easier on yourself as well. The Attorney General also, as has been discussed, has an enforcement role. We have been given explicit and broad enforcement authority in both the open records and the open meetings areas. We have jurisdiction in Superior Court to seek civil and criminal compliance. I think Tom mentioned earlier, there were almost never any cases or criminal prosecutions under the old law, because the fact is you had to jump through so many hoops to do it, and the most favorable outcome you could get was a $100 fine, which didn't make a whole lot of sense. And we've seen clients who've actually said, you know, how much is it going to cost me to do this? If I violate the law, is it $100? Eh, that's the cost of doing business. I can live with that. And I think government attorneys, again, have a special obligation to advise their clients. Their obligation is to abide by the law, not to look for ways to avoid it. So under the new law, we have broader enforcement authority. We've initiated a couple of actions already under the new law. We've entered into consent agreements with some local governments under the new law. And we have an Attorney General who I will tell you is very aggressive about enforcement of the law, and who, as was mentioned earlier, came out of local government, spent a long time there, so he knows how things operate. And he feels like if they could operate in the confines of the law, then everybody else should be able to as well. So, moving on to ethical considerations. There is a rule that grew out of an open government dispute, which really was one of sort of constitutional proportions in this state. Back in the mid-80s, the State Personnel Board was conducting a disciplinary hearing involving the head of the State Patrol, who at the time was the brother of a powerful legislator, and they chose to have that hearing in private. Now, the Attorney General at the time, who was represented at that meeting by a lawyer who advised them that they were violating the law to conduct the hearing in public, decided that he was going to sue the client to enforce the law. And of course, at that time, I mean, that's largely unheard of. There are a lot of ethical rules out there that are kind of difficult to navigate, but suing your own client is one that's usually pretty easy to avoid. But he did it. And as a consequence, a bar complaint was filed against him that made its way all the way to the Georgia Supreme Court. And the issue was, what is the public official who is a lawyer, what is his obligation and his authority under the law to enforce the law, and how does that interest balance out against his ethical responsibilities under the bar rules? The Supreme Court, as it is often wont to do when it comes to resolving disputes of a constitutional nature involving public officials, sidestepped the issue by adopting a rule and then applying it retroactively to that case. The rule is Rule 9.5. And we can debate the reach of that rule, but it essentially says two things. One, a lawyer who's a public official, which is not defined, and represents the state, a municipal corporation in the state, the U.S. government, their agencies or officials, is bound by the bar rules. That seems pretty straightforward. But the no provision of the rules shall be construed to prohibit such a lawyer from taking a legal position adverse to the state, the U.S. government, their agencies or officials, when such action is authorized or required by the U.S. Constitution, the Georgia Constitution, or statutes of the United States or Georgia. All this is to say, in my view, that a public attorney's ethical responsibilities are different than a traditional private lawyer's duties. The client's interest has to be weighed against the public interest, and the public lawyer has an obligation to assure that the law is followed. So if you're a public lawyer or a private lawyer representing a public agency, you should ask yourself these questions. Is the client acting in good faith and obeying the law? Your obligation is to assure that they are. Do you have a duty to adequately inform the client on the requirements of the law? Yes. You know, in our office, we take that so seriously that we do not let lawyers advise a client either that a record is not open or a meeting can be closed unless it's an absolute, well-settled, straightforward idea without front office approval. And that means that either the Attorney General or I have to agree that the advice they're given is appropriate. That's how seriously we take that, because we don't want clients being able to steamroll over a junior lawyer attending a meeting or giving advice. Because our duty is to the law first and foremost. And so we make clear that they have to get that approval. And it, frankly, it puts us on the line. I mean, so you know, if you're out there, if you're representing a requester and an exception is being asserted or a meeting is being closed, that it's likely being done, that has, it has received the attention probably all the way to the Attorney General before it's been done. Likewise, we tell our lawyers to report any failure to follow our advice on open records or open meetings laws to the front office. We want to know if a client is not following our advice. That's not to say that we don't have disagreements, and that's not to say that our clients sometimes don't have a position that is defensible, where there is a genuine question as to the application of the law. But on the other hand, if we have taken a position on it, then we take the position that our advice is binding on them, and they have to follow. Do you as a public lawyer have a duty to intervene when the client ceases to follow the law? I think where this comes up a lot of times is when agencies or local governments, governing bodies go into executive session. They go into executive session to discuss attorney-client privilege materials. And then they quickly stray from the discussion of attorney-client privilege information into other topics. Your obligation is to tell them to stop. The new law suggests that the meeting should be adjourned if there is a refusal to cease the discussions. But unfortunately, the people who are involved in the discussions are usually the ones who are in a position to adjourn the meeting, and they don't. Our lawyers are instructed to leave. We are not going to be part of a violation of the law. And obviously, if the purported reason for the executive session is attorney-client privilege and the attorney's no longer in the meeting, it's going to be very hard to argue that that discussion was appropriate. So that makes it nice and clean. I guess the bottom line on that to me is that, you know, public lawyers are not potted plants. And you're there to give advice and to make sure that the law is followed. And our obligation in our office may be higher than in some other public agencies and local governments, but I urge you all to take it seriously. Now, do you have a duty to speak up and reveal violations of the law? That's a hard one. If your advice was to open a meeting, but the client ignores the advice, can you make that advice public? We generally err on the side of saying compliance with the law by a public agency is more important than confidentiality. There's no law on that in Georgia that I'm aware of. Other states have addressed it head on. For example, Hawaii, I know, provides that a lawyer may reveal information related to representation of a client if the attorney reasonably believes it is necessary to prevent a public official or public agency from committing a criminal or illegal act that a government lawyer reasonably believes is likely to result in harm to the public good, or to rectify the consequences of a public official's or a public agency's act, which the government lawyer reasonably believes to have been criminal or illegal and harmful to the public good. We know unequivocally that a violation of the open records and open meetings law is against the public interest. The statute tells us that directly. So to me, that's a very easy balance to make. The public good is embodied in the language of the statute itself. Again, some states are very specific about that, and others are not. Georgia, there's no law. I think it's worth the debate, though. And I will tell you, in the past, there have been instances where we have released advice. The other thing is, I mean, when you get caught up in all these open records and open meetings discussions and whether information should be released or not, you know, keep in mind that the law just says, one, that meetings are presumed to be open and records are presumed to be open. And there are lots of exceptions, but the exceptions in most cases aren't mandatory. There are a lot of things that can be released that don't violate the law to release them. And just because you have an exception doesn't mean you have to assert. And frankly, that's true of the attorney-client privilege. And we have, on occasion, advised clients that we thought it was in their best interest to waive the privilege and release a document. That may be a foreign concept to a lot of folks in the private sector, but we do that all the time. I mean, there are many, many cases where we have no objection to the release of the record. And the thing about the law, the nice thing about the law, is that there's a trade-off for all this extra responsibility that public lawyers have to ensure compliance. And one is that the law provides good faith defenses when information is mistakenly made public. So again, in keeping with the idea that the law says, err on the side of openness, it then provides protection to you and says, as long as you're acting in good faith in releasing information, you're going to be protected from liability. And I think that's important. It also provides for good faith defenses in criminal enforcement actions. Now, I'm going to tell you something that I have a lot of concerns about in this area. And this is just my personal view. I have a sense, and I fear, that a lot of public entities are going to hide behind that exception. I think a lot of them are going to say, our lawyer was sitting there in the room and didn't tell us that we couldn't do this. Or our lawyer gave us advice that we relied on, so we per se had to be acting in good faith because we were acting on the advice of our counsel. And we've already seen that in a couple of cases. I can just tell you from our perspective, we are going to look beyond that assertion in any case where we're trying to determine whether or not there was in fact a good faith basis for the denial of records or access to a meeting. I think that is always going to involve a factual inquiry as to whether or not good faith in fact existed. If an attorney provides advice that they know is wrong, or that any reasonable attorney would have known was wrong, I don't think they're acting in good faith, and I don't think the client is necessarily acting in good faith to rely on that advice. So I will just say from our perspective, that's something that we're going to look at closely. I guess my bottom line on all of this is that we take this, our office certainly takes our responsibility under the law very seriously, both in terms of advising our clients and the enforcement mechanisms that are now available to us to make sure that everyone else is in compliance with the law. I would urge all of my fellow public attorneys to accept the higher responsibility that the law places on them and that Rule 9.5 places on them to assure that the public interest is protected. And with that, I guess we'll open it to questions, recognizing that we're the only thing between you and lunch.
Where I work, we frequently get requests from attorneys for records that it's a different agency. They confuse us with the materials that we keep. So in thinking about, you know, having that phone conversation, do I then have an obligation to respond within 3 days in writing that just says, you know, you really have to, this isn't us? Is that part of what you would advise? I mean, we do that, but do you think that's a part of what the open records law requires?
Well, I think you do. You have to respond. I mean, even if you're the wrong agency, you have to respond. And even if the answer is, we don't have any such records, I think you have to do that.
So my question was, if I pick up the phone and
right.
I say, you know, I really think you are asking the wrong thing, I still need to respond in writing, is what you're saying.
Well, I don't think you're compelled to respond in writing. I think it's in your probably in your interest to respond in writing, just like it's in the requester's interest to request in writing. I mean, one of the reasons that that's in the law, that the request for enforcement purposes has to be in writing, Frankly, it's just a matter of proof. We get a lot of complaints that are sort of the, you know, government open records equivalent of he said, she said. And there's no way for us to know what the requester really asked for, or if they asked for it, or when they asked for it. And a lot of times the disputes come down to sort of nuances of what the request really was. And so we thought it was appropriate to have in there in the law. If you're going to ask us to come in and enforce this, then we need to know what we're enforcing. We need to know what the request was. We need to know what the response was. So I think it's important to, for your own good to have something. But I would also take that a step further, and I think you said you probably do. You pick up the phone and call them and say, you know, you really asked the wrong agency. But if you can help them get to the right agency, I would encourage you to do that.
And that's what we do. And we do send a letter, but yeah. I was just thinking, if I get a breather, if I still have to do it within 3 days, if I've already had that conversation, they say thanks.
Yeah, you can just give a confirming email. I think that would actually comply, especially if you've got an attorney on the other end.
Anything else?
Just so that I'm not confused, how do you define, or how does the Attorney General's Office define what you said was a quote-unquote public lawyer as compared to a private attorney who's representing a public agency?
Well, I mean, frankly, to me, I'm not the state bar, I don't regulate lawyers, but to me, the obligation is the same. If you're a private attorney representing a public interest, you are fulfilling a public function, as far as I'm concerned. I just don't see a lot of difference there.
Yes, although I would have to say that, you know, there are ways to access judicial records through other means.
But I know that courts have been getting, like, for example, we represent a county with all of the constitutional officers in it, and our superior court got, I think it was actually magistrate court, they wanted copies of all complaints filed within, like, a six-month period. Well, those are, you can get those anyway. You go to the court, you can get them. But they wanted them on a disk, which was going to take a huge amount of time. In that case, does the court even have to respond?
Well, apart from the open records law, there's a common law and a constitutional right of access to court records. And that would include a complaint, for example. And there's a lot of 11th Circuit case law about, you know, especially filed documents are going to be subject to the common law and constitutional right of access to court records.
And can I just add to that, that judicial records, a lot, I mean, I don't think it's a great deal of dispute, but a lot of the judiciary does not consider administrative or budgetary records. They respond to open records requests as related to that.
Right. I think it's very difficult sometimes to draw that line, especially from a county perspective of when you're looking at budget and things like that. And I'll tell you something else. I mean, even regular records, I've written letters on behalf of the Georgia Supreme Court that start with the line, you know, we're not subject to the act, however, we are producing these records anyway. And I think, you know, I think a lot of courts will be responsive. But again, it goes to this idea that, you know, you can voluntarily produce whatever records you feel are appropriate.
All right, well, thank you both. thanks, everyone. For the public agency folks, a lot of folks have already asked me, if you want the Georgia First Amendment Foundation to come and do kind of like a brown bag lunch and talk open records and meetings, that's what we do all the time. It's Sean and Jerry and me and others. So we can do that if you think that would help your agency. So keep that in mind, and I'll hang around with some business cards afterwards. Thanks, everyone, so much for being here.